Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so the quick summary of the main topics. You know, some of you who've been since yesterday kind of get the idea here. So I'll talk about the first one. Chris will say a couple of words about the second one. So we now have these enormous code corpora, you know, from GitHub and Bitbucket and all this, and you know, it includes not just the code in many different languages, but also change history, bug reports. We have question and answer on Stack Overflow. We have comments in the code. We have comments in pull requests. We have comments relating to the actual content, comments relating to the development process. So this is a lot of stuff. And you know, the exciting thing that's been discussed in this workshop, that sort of triggered this workshop, is that the statistics in these corpora of code very much resemble the statistics in natural language corpora. And so the question is, you know, so we know a lot of things we can do with corpora that have statistics like the kind we find in natural language. So what can we do with this stuff? So that's one of the motivators for the workshop.
And then looking at it from the other aspect, so I think NLP several decades ago was focused primarily on sort of intrinsic natural language tasks, like trying to take a natural language string and identify what are the part of speech tags, what are the underlying parse tree, and so on. We've gotten pretty good at that, maybe not perfect, but pretty good. But now there's a greater push towards applying NLP to tasks, whether they be for software engineering or end user programming or querying data more effectively. So looking at taking these NLP approaches that are aimed at generating formal representations and making those formal representations be actual code or programs, or in the opposite direction, taking code or programs or formal representations and learning to generate natural language expressions from them, these are all really interesting active areas of research. So to get people from the SE community who have a lot more experience on the program synthesis side, together with people from the NL side who are reaching closer and closer into that space, seems like there's some ripe opportunities for collaboration and data set building. So, yeah.
Thanks. So sort of broadly, the goals for the workshop is to get NLP people interested in software corpora and software engineering problems. So if you're an NLP person, you know, we hope you'll have a chance to interact with software engineers and kind of find out what, you know, what gets us up in the morning and what we care about and what kind of data we have that you might be able to use. And if you're an SE researcher, the hope is that, you know, can I get to interact with NLP people? You know, they're and the kind of approaches they use, the sort of statistics they use, the kind of algorithms they use over large data sets. So hopefully by the time you leave, you have a brand new collaboration that hopefully you can, come up with some really interesting ideas and go to Sol and ask for money or intern at Microsoft and do some exciting things.
Or work full-time hires too. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
So I've interned at Microsoft. I can certainly say it's a wonderful experience. We want to produce a report that sort of outlines the future agenda in the area of exciting things that could be done with these approaches. So the workshop has a bunch of topical sessions. So this is the first topical session. This is supposed to be about general overview of software engineering problems and what can be done with NLP approaches. And other sessions have similar kinds of, but usually shorter talks. This one begins with the keynote. And so we're going to have a 30-second round of introductions fairly soon. And then we have one session with 2-minute madness where everybody stands up and talks for 2 minutes about what they're working on and what they care about. We have one session devoted entirely to data availability and data needs. That's going to be led by Tien Nguyen, who's going to talk about this exciting system he's got called BOA, which allows you to query over very large software corpora. All sessions are going to be scribed. There are scribes that have been appointed for different sessions. Usually, they'll be able to write something up on what the discussions are. So this is the structure of each session. It begins with a mood setting talk, and then the focus is on discussions to, you know, hear your thoughts on problems and opportunities. And then we'll try to summarize each session the best we can, and then we'll outline, hopefully at the end, we'll outline the research agenda. So the sessions today, this is the introductory session. The second one is data opportunities, talk by Nguyen. So the 30-second introductions will go in here. And then we have a 2-Minute Madness, session 3. Session 4 is Code and Program Modeling with talks by Barr and Tarlow. And session 5 is Ontologies and Understanding of Code Semantics with talks by Jane Clean and Huang. Sessions tomorrow, Information Retrieval, talk by Andrea and Marcus. And then Language Generation from Code, talk by Graham Neubig. Natural Language Programming and Semantic Parsing, a bunch of different talks. And then the final session is a rump session. And if you want to get together with people and focus on particular topics, either subtopics of this or other ones we didn't think of, you know, let us know. We'll try to arrange something. It'll all be in this room. We have tables and spaces to talk. So our expectations of you is basically, you know, ask questions. You know, please be, you know, very active and ask a lot of questions and help us kind of figure out what the interesting problems, what are the challenges, what should we focus on. And you know, if you're a session chair, please, you know, think about like what you'd like to, how you'd like to summarize the session that you're leading. So with that, we'll turn over to Chris to introduce the keynote speaker.
Sure. Oh yeah. Do we want to do our introductions first or after, Charles? Like our 30-second.
We can do that now.
Yeah, I was thinking maybe we could take this opportunity to just walk around the room, do our quick 30-second intros, and then I'll introduce Charles. Yeah. So maybe I should go first, just to kind of set the tone. So my name is Chris Quirk. I'm a researcher here in the Natural Language Processing Group at Microsoft Research. I'm primarily interested, for the auspices of this workshop, in data-driven end-user programming. And while I'm here, I'd love to find collaborators and data sets. So.
Prem Devanbu, I work in software engineering, and I've been really interested in applying NLP-based statistical methods to software engineering problems for the past 3 or 4 years. I'm from UC Davis.
Bansal. I'm a new PhD student at the University of Washington. I'm interested in AI and NLP. I just finished my undergraduate in May. I worked on summarization before. Now I'm looking at program synthesis and natural language processing.
Hi, I'm Vladimir Filkov. I'm a professor at UC Davis. And I'm very interested in the socio-technical underpinnings of code and how people organize to create good code and the language and code interface is very interesting to me.
Hi, I'm Razvan Bunescu. I work at the School of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science at Ohio University. I'm interested in cross-language information retrieval queries in natural language. The answer is code or something that contains code. And I'm here to learn more about sort of repositories and possibly semantic representations of code.
Just a quick request, please speak as loudly as you can, just so that we can all hear. Thank you.
Stand up.
Okay, great.
My name is Chen Liu. I'm an associate professor in computer science from Ohio University. My background is in software engineering, and I work with NLP researchers like Razvan, where we work together to apply natural language processing techniques on software engineering problems. And I'm also interested in making the results that we already have, make them relevant to developers, because right now we have results, but the developers, you know, we need to fit into their workflow.
My name is Tao Xie. I'm a faculty member from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. My areas are primary software testing analysis, along with software analytics, with focus on textual analytics, along with other NLP techniques for machine learning for software engineering problems. Recently, we also started looking at security problems thanks to NSF. We recently have a project supporting us in collaborating with information retrieval NLP professor Chen Xiangzai, also for our department, along with a security professor Carl Gunther and NCC professor William Ink, and together tackling this mobile app security problem with natural language processing techniques.
Hey, my name is Srini Iyer. I'm a second year PhD student at the University of Washington in the computer science program. And I am interested in summarizing database queries and in general making it easier for people to formulate database queries using natural language.
My name is Sonia Hajduk. I'm an assistant professor at Florida State University. My background is software engineering. I'm focusing mostly on software maintenance and evolution. And I'm interested in code search, and bug location mostly. And I'm applying information retrieval techniques and natural language processing for searching code.
I'm Andy Marcus at UT Dallas. I've been working in software engineering, applying text retrieval for 15 years now, together with my current and past students. Some of them are here and their students as well. We solved a variety of problems in software engineering with text retrieval. Tomorrow morning, I'll talk about some of them.
Hi, my name is Valera Noduva. I'm at Washington State University, assistant professor. I'm interested in applying natural language processing tools to software engineering from the point of view of quality of the lexicon, so quality of identifiers and comments.
Hi, I'm Dawn Loring from Loyola University, Maryland. My background is in information retrieval, and I've been collaborating with Dave Winkley, a software engineer, for the last 10 years or so. And so I've been looking at the intersection of information retrieval and software engineering, and really looking for problems where there are differences from retrieving natural language and retrieving source code.
My name is Martin White. I'm a PhD student at William & Mary, studying under Dennis. We're looking at deep learning applications for software engineering, particularly for applications like language modeling, code clone detection. We're also interested in program repair.
Hi, my name is Vincent Hellendorn. I study software engineering at UC Davis. I've been working on applications of naturalness to source codes, like bug detection, code completion. And I'm here because I want to improve my understanding of NLP techniques and refine my perspective on what naturalness of source code means.
Hi, my name is Dana. I'm also with Satias. I recently graduated from Carnegie Mellon University. I work with William Cohen. I'm interested in building ontologies and knowledge bases for the software domain and other domains from unstructured data, natural language. And I'm here to learn about software tasks that can benefit from structured software.
Hi, I'm Melvin Chang. I just joined the University of Washington in January. My background is in program synthesis, program languages, and also in databases. So I work on end-user programming and also looking at some of these big code program problems.
My name is Dennis Pushvanik, Associate Professor of Computer Science in the College of William & Mary. I'm interested in applications of information retrieval, NLP, and machine learning for various software engineering needs.
Hi, I'm Christian Bird. I came all the way from Microsoft Research Redmond this morning. I'm a researcher at Microsoft Research. I do a lot of empirical software engineering studies, and the reason I'm here is I'm interested in applying some of this naturalist study of software to pragmatic tools in the IDE and code review, those types of software engineering processes.
So I'm Jin Dong
Su
from UC Davis. Work mostly in programming languages and software engineering, so I'm very interested in algorithms for analyzing code and also algorithms for generating code. And also I'm interested in understanding how we program, how we should program, and also understand how we should teach students how to learn coding.
Okay, so I'm Mark Marin. I'm also from Microsoft Research. I have a variety of interests in how natural language processing and software engineering or programming languages interact. In particular, sort of this notion of what is natural code or natural idiomatic uses of structures is interesting to me. For example, a big challenge in this area of program synthesis is given a specification, we can generate lots of programs that match the specification. Some of them look nice and neat and natural. Some of them look very much less so. So trying to nail down what this notion of a human written program looks like and using that in that sort of task would be very interesting to me.
Hi, I'm Will Barr. I'm a senior lecturer at the University College London. I'm interested in, so bugs have famously been described as anomalous or deviant behavior. And to date, capturing that behavior has been of the sort that you know, humans know it when they see it, but we've had trouble making that algorithmically detectable. And I'm interested in approaches that will, you know, bridge that gap. It's sort of what Mark was just talking about. We have, you know, what's this? What is? What makes something idiomatic and natural? What makes something unnatural and bizarre? And that's something I'd like to make some progress on here at this workshop. And I'm hoping to meet collaborators or potential collaborators in machine learning.
Hi, everyone. I am Tian Nguyen, associate professor at the Computer Engineering Department at Iowa State University. My background is in software engineering, and I have been working on software mining repository. And I'm interested in applying the statistical model in natural language processing techniques in various software engineering tasks. And one of the typical solution and approach that we'll present later is mining the large-scale ghost corpus.
Hi everybody, my name is Yiwei. I'm a research engineer from Microsoft Research Cambridge. I've been working on a project called Developer Assistant for a couple of years. The main goal is to answer natural language queries asked by programmers in an IDE. A typical query is send email to X with attachment Y, where X is a string variable pointing to an email address and Y is a string variable pointing to a file location. So we are trying different methods, different synthesizers to generate code in this fashion. So in the future, programmers will be, programming will be easier, hopefully.
Hi, I'm Ray Mooney. I'm a professor of computer science at the University of Texas at Austin. I've done a lot of work in semantic parsing over the past 20 years, and actually, you all have called me the grandfather of semantic parsing. I don't really like that. But I've gotten more interested, which has done a lot of work on like mapping to database queries, but I've gotten interested more recently, particularly when I did a sabbatical here last fall, on how we could map natural language to other types of programs, and recently done some work with Chris on that. And also, I was sort of around at the genesis of the idea of this. Chris and I were reminiscing about it back when I was here a little over a year ago. And so I'm really glad to see you all here, and thanks to NSF for supporting this.
Hi, I'm Yoav. I'm a faculty in Cornell, and I'm the one who presented Ray as my academic grandpa at some point or another. Apparently he won't never forget that. So I'm working on natural language processing, and more specifically about natural language understanding in interactive scenarios, where the goal is to really map language to formal and expressive representations that system can respond to and really generate an interaction.
Hi, I'm Ashish Vaswani. I'm a scientist at the USC Information Sciences Institute. So some of my research has been training large-scale, large vocabulary neural networks for language modeling, and I'm interested in applying those for code and playing around with some of this stuff with Prem and students.
My name is Graham Neubig. I'm an assistant professor at the Nara Institute of Science and Technology in Japan. I do a lot of things, but mainly machine translation is my specialty, and I'm recently interested in translating between natural language and code, and code and natural language. The reason why I'm here is because creating data for this is really annoying, and I hope that somebody will do it for me.
Hi, I'm Zhiling, and I'm from Carnegie Mellon University. I'm currently a first-year PhD student, and I am working with Professor William Cole and Professor Rustin, so I'm good enough. So my background was in machine learning and natural language processing, and currently I'm working on the semi-supervised learning problem with application in natural language processing and software engineering.
Yeah, my name is Jane Cleland Wong. I'm from I'm a professor at DePaul University in Chicago, and the area that I work in is called software traceability. So it's really all about connecting things together, and in particular, we noticed a few years ago that a lot of people have been working in this area, and the results that we get using information retrieval and machine learning kind of hit a glass wall, and you can't make the connections. And so we've been working over the last few years on a much more intelligent traceability solution that includes ontology, natural language processing, and then reasoning over the knowledge that we gain. And we apply this for supporting traceability tasks and for querying across software projects for analytics purposes.
Hi, my name is David Chang from the University of Notre Dame. My research is in natural language processing and machine translation. Two areas that I've been focusing recently are neural networks, like many people, and formalisms for generating and transforming graphs. And I'm interested in seeing whether both of those areas could be applied to code in natural language.
I'm Colin McMillan from the University of Notre Dame, as assistant faculty at Notre Dame. It is an honor to be here, so thank you for the invitation. I work in the area of software engineering. I'm particularly interested in natural language generation for the purposes of automatic documentation generation and also accessibility technologies for those with visual disabilities.
Hi, my name is Abram Hindle. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Alberta in Canada. I'm interested in statistical modeling of source code, particularly for debugging and for energy consumption. My student Joshua Campbell has worked on applying naturalness to error location. Turns out that when you train a corpus on good code, it's surprised by bad code. Sort of surprising. I'm here because I want to see what people are doing with naturalness, and I'm also interested in learning more about how to apply deep learning to any kind of naturalness-related problems.
That's cool. So I'm Patrick Reichstrom. I'm a research scientist, and I'm also the technical lead for the IBM Watson tooling effort. So I'm in charge of the team that builds all sorts of tools to allow end users to configure and train Watson and all of our associated services that we do. One of the things that I'm most interested about being here is the connection that new people who aren't like machine learning black belts need to do to understand how to train one of these systems, and what that means from a software engineering perspective, whether it's understanding what to do next, understanding the impact and what they've done, and understanding what the heck they did that caused the system to regress. So that's my interest.
I'm Saul Greenspan from the National Science Foundation. Most of my career was in industry working on software engineering problems. My past work was on knowledge representation and reasoning for requirements engineering. Since requirements are about models of the world, then rather than about the objects you put in a computer program, semantic networks and logic seemed like, you know, ways of doing that. So I've been at NSF about 10 or 12 years, and maybe we'll have a chance tomorrow to say a little more about this, but I also participate in the program on secure and trustworthy cyberspaces. So if any of you are interested in talking about that as a place to do research, you know, we can chat.
Tanya Kowalski from NSF. I am in SAIS, but in the Information and Intelligence Systems Division, in a program which is called Robust Intelligence, where I'm taking care of human language and communication. Now, my background, my bachelor actually was in mathematical logic and formal methods. So I shifted to natural language processing exactly from kind of formal methods in software engineering. And so when we started getting those proposals, I was actually very happy because it put me back to, you know, like in the exactly, because at that time there were some attempts in the 60s, late 60s, 70s to do, like, for instance, generation of documentation. But it was kind of, at that time, both disciplines were probably not yet ready to have a mature synthesis. So I have to admit also that I have a slightly hidden agenda here, because in NLP, there are more female researchers as compared to computer science, to software engineering. And since I myself did a lot of programming when I was way back in graduate school, I think that more, if, for instance, our NLP researchers can bring more of their female graduate students into these interesting collaborations, we can get somehow more female researchers also in computer science, or at least at the border of computer science and computational linguistics, which would be extremely fruitful and also encouraging, you know, telling the female researchers that it's not very boring.
So, hello everybody. My name is Martin Montperus. I'm with the University of Lille in France.
Among the things I've done on NLP and software engineering, so I'm on the software engineering side, but we've done a system that takes a set of unstructured mailing lists and creates a structured question and answer set from this. And now I'm working on program repairs. This is my main expertise. And in program repairs, so you try to generate patches for a given bug, and there are two challenges. The first one is to find a patch, indeed. But the second one is that the patch is good code. It's good with respect to the specification. It's also good with respect to what humans would expect. And so according to this, there are many, so it comes to what Earl has said. I'm really interested in all what would be said here to be able to generate good-looking code, and more than good-looking, it has to be both good-looking and correct. Because in program repair, we've seen experiments where it's quite easy to find a straightforward patch, which looks good, but which is indeed incorrect with respect to the rest of the spec. And on the other hand, it's also quite easy, depending on the technique that you use, to generate a very complex patch, which is unmaintainable in the long term. So there is a trade-off to find, and this is what I'm looking for today.
I'm Luke Zettelmeyer. I'm a faculty at the University of Washington, so I also had a very easy commute on a public bus across the lake. I'm interested in semantics, machine learning, empirical approaches for recovering representations of the meaning of text. One interesting challenge we have is even thinking about how to represent meaning. It's a pretty open problem, and there's interesting relationships between sort of program semantics and code there that I'm very excited about, and I'd love to talk to people about. And the second thing that gets me really excited about this research area is issues of big data and scale. So it's often really hard for us to find data sets to do computational semantics, and there's lots of code out there and lots of text written about it, and I think that could really be a game changer for us if we can find the right collaborations.
Hey everyone, my name is Nate. I just finished at MIT, and I'm gonna be starting at MSR Cambridge in the fall. And I come at this from the NLP side, but I'm very interested, or I've worked on generating programs from natural language descriptions for end user programming. And I'm also very interested in taking advantage of the scale that we have in terms of available existing natural language resources and existing code bases, and how can we use that scale to help improve the learning process.
Hi, I'm Danny Carlo. I'm a researcher at Microsoft Research in Cambridge, England. So I'm interested in statistical models of source code, joint models of natural language and source code. And recently, I've also been interested in getting more at the semantics of code within models and looking at problems, for example, from program verification using machine learning tools. And I'm here because I think it's a really cool community, and I just want to see what everybody's up to.
My name is Jennifer D'Souza. My background is in natural language processing. I'm working as a postdoc with Prem and Vladimir. I'm interested in joint modeling of natural language and software. And I'm here to understand about, to gain an understanding of the possibilities that can be explored in applying NLP to software engineering tasks.
Picture of Charles. Take off your glasses, maybe the resemblance is a little better. So Charles is at kind of a distinct disadvantage because he doesn't get to introduce himself. Instead, I get to introduce him, sorry. I first became aware of Charles's work when he was doing his PhD under Andrew McCallum. He was doing some structure prediction work that was directly relevant to a number of things happening in the natural language processing field at the time. Really great work, and I was excited to follow what was going on there. Honestly, I kind of lost track of him for a while after that. I didn't realize what he was doing. And then several years ago, I started to get more interest in this sort of applying natural language processing tools to code, only to find that, like, Charles was years ahead of me. So he's been doing a series of great work applying natural language processing tools such as language models and grammar-based approaches, tree substitution grammars for identifying idioms within code. And so it's my pleasure to invite him here today to talk about some of the new work that's going on in software processing and tools. Thanks, Charles.
So thanks, thanks for that introduction, and thanks for the invitation to speak here. So what I want to do in this talk is to give an overview of what's happening in this new confluence between statistical machine learning, statistical natural language processing, programming languages, and software engineering. So so first, before I do that, I want to talk about, you know, why are we meeting now as opposed to 10 years ago or 10 years from now? And when you think about any kind of statistical analysis or machine learning, it's the first thing you need is data. So if you come to me as a machine learning person and say, oh, I've got this new idea, the first thing I'm going to ask you is, okay, what data set are you going to use? And there are new opportunities here which on the side of data, which is kind of spurring a lot of the work that's been going on. Now, you can't say that open source software is new. There's been open source for probably as long as there's been software. But maybe you can say that there's more of software development out in the open in the past 5 years. So if the if you think about kind of the open source ecosystem, so the previous maybe standard or place where people were coming together over open source was SourceForge, and it was very successful. As of 2014, they claimed something like 430,000 open source projects on SourceForge. But it's probably fair to say that this has been superseded a bit by a new generation of tools. And two examples of these are GitHub and Stack Overflow. So if you see what this line is showing over the years is that just the number of pull requests that are happening per year on GitHub. So what a pull request is if somebody has an open source project that I like and I want to contribute to, I make a full copy of it into my own area, I might make some changes, and then I kind of push them upstream. And that kind of upstream request is called a pull request. I'm asking you to pull changes from you. So even in what, so this is kind of a measure of the amount of vitality, the amount of interaction between projects. So so this has been going up to a rate of, you know, almost 6 million pull requests last year. Or another example of this kind of collaborative development is Stack Overflow, a question and answer site that you've probably all seen. And this is also having millions and millions of posts per year. So what you're seeing in this kind of new dimension of tools, I would say, is that there's always been a lot of the software development process online, at least for a small number of popular open source projects. But now you're seeing much, much more of the development interactions for many, many more projects. So there's a real chance to discover how software developers communicate. And you know, relevant to that, there's a specific kind of communication that you might not think about at first. And to think about that, I want to talk about the term programming language, which is one we don't kind of stop to think about as much. Really, the term language in PL, it's a metaphor, right? We're comparing programming languages metaphorically to natural language. And in one sense, that's a really, really bad metaphor, because there's so much richer communication that's possible in natural language than there is in programming language. But in another sense, it's actually a really good metaphor. And the reason for that is that computer program source code, it's a means of human communication. This is what we tell all of our first year undergraduates in computer science, that you're not just writing code for yourself, you are also writing code for other people to read. So now I'm not saying that, you know, we would necessarily want to conduct all of our social interactions in programming language, although for some of us that's all we have. But it does raise an opportunity that we can take some of the same tools that we use statistically to study how people communicate in natural language and apply them to the text of programming language and see if there are patterns that we can learn from this type of communication. So when I think about communication about software, you know, what are software developers communicating about? And there are, you know, pretty much any aspect of the software is going to be complex enough that it requires intense communication between developers. So, you know, one type of thing that developers are talking about is how the code works. So, you know, what architecture is the code using? What algorithms and data structures? You know, what are parts of the program that interact in a particularly detailed and unexpected way? And another type of thing that you see, especially in comments, is actually why was the code written in a certain way that it was? Why did I have to check that this variable was null here when you would have thought, just kind of glancing at the code, that we already know it can't be null? Or, you know, why did I decide to call this particular protocol or use this particular algorithm when that wasn't apparent that that was the right decision if you didn't understand the domain very well? So there's all kinds of miniature explanations that happen kind of in the comments of the code of why did I have to write it the way that I did, or why did I have to make this particular patch? And another type of thing that they talk about is how do I reuse code? You know, how do I use this API? You know, what are the preconditions for a particular type of method that I might reuse? You know, what are corner cases that I might be careful about? And there's also indirect information about how to maintain code. So, you know, if certain areas in the code look really kind of, you know, information dense with, you know, 3-character variable names that have no vowels in them, you know, that's kind of a signal from the original developer that you actually don't want to modify this part of the code. You know, you shouldn't even bother. And there's also information about what areas of the code are higher risk. So the fix me is not actually referring to my slide. It's actually an example of, you know, we've all seen comments that say, look, there are a couple of problems here that might crop up later. So, you know, there are a lot of different things that programmers want to communicate about, and there are a lot of different modalities that programmers use to communicate. So if we start with thinking about the code itself, obviously the comments in the code are an obvious modality, but also the names and the structure of the code convey a lot of information into what's going on. And then there's also natural language communication in addition to this, in terms of discussion forums, email lists. And so those are communication between developers, and there's also communication from developers to the outside world, so design documents and product reviews and so on and so forth. So there's a large range of different types of communication that's going on. And if I think with my hat as having done research in natural language processing, one thing that's very exciting about this kind of confluence is any problem that you wanted to work on in natural language processing, there is an analog in kind of software engineering and programming languages. You know, if you wanted to do kind of low-level but important kind of correction or auto-completion, you can do that. If you want to do natural language summarization, you can do summarization of code. If you want to generate natural language, you can generate code. And we've had several people here say they talk about machine translation. You know, question answering, there's, you know, people answer millions of questions per year manually. Wouldn't we want to do that automatically? If you want kind of semantic parsing, we see we have, it was also kind of very important and useful within software engineering. We'll hear about that again and again in the course of the workshop. If you want to do more kind of semantic reasoning, like semantic entailment, or kind of connecting semantics between natural language terms and the outside world, that's sometimes called grounding. You know, they're very natural use cases for that in code. If you want to do information extraction, information retrieval, you know, there are various points in software engineering where we need to do that. And even if you just want to do parsing, you would think that's a solved problem with code, right? It's a deterministic grammar. But it turns out there are good reasons to want to do even statistical parsing with code. So that can be the proof that, you know, anything you'd want to do with natural language, it could also make sense to do with natural language discussion of programming language or programming language text. And over the course of this the survey, I'll show examples of as many of these as I can. In particular, I'll show the ones in the yellow stars. So you can kind of keep your eyes open throughout the talk of, you know, when you see a yellow star, it might refer to one of your favorite problems from natural language processing. And similar, so that's from the perspective of why, if what you really care about is doing NLP, it's kind of really interesting to care about this kind of new interaction, this new emerging area. But similarly, if you care about software development, if you're a software engineering or you're a programming languages researcher, I think one of the exciting things about this area is any task that has to do with software can benefit from this type of statistical language analysis, whether it's to do with requirements engineering, kind of software architecture, you know, how you implement systems, reading code, navigating through code, how you maintain, fix, and optimize code, how you do testing and validation, doing refactoring, doing porting, pretty much any of these things, they result in data sets that have physicals, that have symbols in them, that have symbolic data, that we could then apply the methods from statistical NLP to. And I think many of these have already been started to be explored by people in this room in part. And there are many of these that I think are also open. So in particular, the ones that I've indicated by the red stars are ones that I'm going to particularly highlight at different points during the talk. So you can keep your eyes open for yellow stars and for red stars. So it'll be like being in kindergarten again. Be very nice. So what I'm going to start with is, there's been a particular upsurge of interest in this area, I think, in the past 5 years. But even if you go back further than that, there's a few threads of research about doing, you know, statistical symbolic analysis of, you know, programs or executable representations that are, you know, maybe particularly relevant to this area. So spend a little bit of time going through, you know, what you might call earlier precursors. So one of those is this research area in software engineering about mining software repositories. So this is something where Tao gave a really nice tutorial yesterday. And what this area of mining software repositories is about, it's been around at least 15 years, maybe even a bit longer. Is it 15, 20? I'm not sure. And this is when people started to notice a lot of kind of open source repositories, you know, not just repositories of source code, but also bug repositories, mailing lists, discussion forums, and thought, wow, this has a lot of information implicit in it about how you can do good software engineering. So can we do, you know, I guess what we now call data science on all of these repositories and learn something new about how we should develop software? So a lot of this work is about applying, you know, existing methods from statistics, machine learning, and sometimes natural language processing or text processing to kind of really interesting data sets. So the types of problems they've thought about are, oh, you know, how can I do bug localization? Like, if you give me a bug report, can I predict where in the code is most relevant for it? Or doing kind of decision support about how I should manage software teams. So that's you know, that's one kind of strand of work that I think is kind of very relevant and has helped to lead into the current interest in this area. And so if I go to from the natural language side, one of the areas that we've heard about a lot already in this workshop is semantic parsing. So this is something that goes back to the 70s. It's basically about converting natural language, either queries, sentences, questions, into some kind of logical or executable representation that I could give directly to a computer. So, there's kind of several example domains from the earlier work in this area would be something like, oh, if I want to kind of talk to a computer doing travel reservations and say, okay, what flights are available from here to here at this time? Another kind of interesting domain is that although a lot of these are about queries and logical forms, they don't have to be. You can also translate into instructions or executable representations. And one example of this is from RoboCup. You're converting kind of coaching instructions in the RoboCup domain from natural language into executable representations. And another example is a particular database about geography that Ray Mooney and collaborators have introduced and has also been kind of a very common test bed for these types of approaches. So I don't want to say too much about semantic parsing, given that, as far as I understand, we have at least two people in the room who've done PhD dissertations in this area, and at least one who's been a grandfather, apparently, in this area, or maybe you'd prefer godfather, I'm not sure. I'm certainly not the best person to answer questions about this area. But if you think the kind of older methods, I said this goes back to the 70s. So the oldest methods for this were rule based. So you'd actually design a set of almost like translation rules between the two. More recently, people, you know, following the statistical revolution in NLP, you know, people have looked at machine learning based methods. So Oh, it must be something when I'm moving my hand. That's interesting. Oh, I'm going the wrong direction. Okay, good. So I need to be careful about touching my phone. So there were some supervised methods. So if you created a data set that had on both sides the natural language question and also whatever the executable or logical representation that you wanted it to map to, and you needed a fair number of these things, then there's a variety of methods that use various different types of principles to kind of try to learn mappings or associations between terms on the natural language side and terms on this logical executable side, and then would learn to do prediction rules between them. One thing I'll highlight about semantic parsing, which is true of a lot of different natural language problems, but it's different than like simple classification in machine learning, is that I'm not just predicting one thing. Like if you have a classifier that says yes, no, will this ad be clicked on, yes, no, which is kind of binary. Whereas when you're predicting a logical form, there's a lot of kind of intermediate decisions you have to make. Oh, do I use this term? Do I use this function? Do I use this quantifier? And all of these decisions interact with each other. So I'm essentially trying to predict an object that has structure rather than trying to predict an isolated object. Those are supervised approaches, but you can also look at, it's all indirect supervision. And this is has been especially interesting more recently. So this is rather than saying I have to tell you what logical form would have given you the correct answer. So that requires specialized expertise. I need to know how to write queries. There are also methods where you just give it the set of question-answer pairs, and the method has to search through the set of logical forms that could have given you the correct answer. And that's been a popular a popular area for more recent work in semantic parsing. So moving back to, so this will be a bit of a whirlwind tour. I'll warn you, I guess I should have warned you earlier. But going back to software engineering, another type of area where which has been about, statistical symbolic analysis of text has been this area of code clones. So this is a bit kind of almost an industry within software engineering. I hope that doesn't sound too pejorative. About finding methods that find, basically kind of like copy-paste fragments that are repeated within software projects. So, and then the idea is, okay, if I identify those, then that'll help you propagate bug fixes from one version to the other, or maybe it'll suggest refactoring opportunities. And so these are about some kind of search procedure for finding matching snippets. It could happen at the lexical level. It could happen at the syntactic level, depending on the work. And they also allow some fuzziness because, lots of times when you do copy and paste, you do a paste and then you make some minor modifications. So there's always some kind of fuzziness factor that's been involved here. And as we heard yesterday in Tao's tutorial, this technology has actually reached the point where it's kind of deployed in practice. It's used by the Microsoft security team and other groups. And the final type of precursor that I wanted to talk about is, so up until now, I've been talking about text, natural language text or source code text, but there's always also been some really influential work on using dynamic instrumentation. So in actually monitoring the state of the program as it's running, converting this into, say, building features of the program state, and then doing some kind of statistical analysis on it. So one kind of piece of well-known work in this area is this work on automatically mining program invariants. So there's this system DICON, which is from across the, is it a river or a pond or something to Seattle? Whatever, the body of water. Is it a bay? I don't know. Okay, that's good. Well, I'm from Scotland, sorry. I don't know what that is. So what this is about is, you dynamically monitor the execution of the program, and you measure certain features of the program state, and then you want to learn invariants. So you want to say, oh, at this point of the program, this variable is often null, or something like that. And then it's essentially using it for something like anomaly detection. So that if later on I saw that, oh, almost all the time this invariant holds, but on some particular run he doesn't hold, then that could be some kind of error that needs to be looked at. Another piece of work that was very influential was on statistical bug isolation. So this was about kind of doing a similar type of instrumentation, but it was the way that it was used is, imagine like when you send a crash report from one of your applications, like your web browser or whatever, and it gets sent back to the mothership, your stack trace, so they can help to do debugging. So what they were saying in this work is, well, why don't we send back some of these dynamic features as well? And then I can train a classifier that says where the input of the classifier was, at this line of code was this variable 0, at this line of code was this string longer than 100, and infinitum. and then use them as features for a classification that says yes, no, did the program crash in this particular way. So the idea is the most informative features for this would be kind of useful clues for debugging. So that's kind of my whirlwind tour of the kind of older threads of work that have led into the current this current explosion of interest. So now I want to talk a little bit more specifically about what's been going on more recently. So this will involve kind of describing the work of actually a lot of the people in this room, which is always a bit uncomfortable to describe someone's own research to them. So to kind of keep things interesting, what I'm going to do is at random points during the talk, I'm going to intentionally mischaracterize some of the work of people in this room. And that's just to make for a more lively discussion. So if I do this for your work, then it means that I like you and I want to involve you in the discussion. So. So I'll start. So this work on code clones is giving some evidence that source code is repetitive. And you know, obviously, I can't do machine learning unless that's the case, right? Because if I want to do prediction, that means that there has to be some feature vector in the training set that's like the one that I'm getting in the test set. Because if there's not, then I've got nothing to do prediction based on. So it's kind of important to do some kind of exploratory work to say, okay, actually, how repetitive is software anyway? So there was this paper from Gamble and Sue 5 years ago, which is just saying if I looked at the level of n-grams, you know, how often is, you know, if I wanted to develop software like a ransom note, where I write a new piece of software by copying and pasting n-grams from older pieces of software, how well could I do at this kind of ransom note type development? And the answer is you could do pretty well. So, you know, even if you go up to 10 grams, which is a fairly, that might be a whole line of code, a 10 gram, you know, about a fifth of them are used kind of elsewhere in the universe of software. And the value of that that number 20% depends on what type of abstraction you do among the n-grams. Like, do you allow exact match? You know, do you abstract away identifier names and so on? But overall, software actually is fairly repetitive. And kind of a newer empirical study that's complementary to this is looking at changes. So if I make some kind of commit to a software project where I'm going to change it, how much of the time could I have found that commit existing already in the project and just kind of grafted it to the new place? And it turns out there's at least a substantial number of commits where you could do that. So at least 10% of commits that you make to software, you could have found something else in the code that you could have 100% grafted it from. So I thought that's kind of very interesting suggestive evidence that code clones aren't the only type of repetition that exist in software, but software is kind of, even when written by professional developers, it's kind of inherently repetitive. So, you know, what can we do with this observation? Well, one thing we can do with this observation is to try to build language models. So there was a paper, this paper you're probably all familiar with at this point on the naturalness of software that appeared a few years ago is, as far as I know, the first paper to apply n-grim language models to computer programs. And so they found, well, it's actually a lot easier to predict identifiers from computer languages than it is human languages. But maybe the most interesting aspect of this work is this scientific question of, you know, what does it mean to be natural? So, I mean, clearly there are aspects to source code that make it easier to read or harder to read from other developers. And that would be something where it'd be really interesting to have a way to, so somewhere where I need to not wave this around. That's my problem. Okay. It'd be interesting to have a way to quantify what makes software natural. So sometimes I see people kind of in trying to explain this idea of naturalness, I see people use the term like predictable and repetitive, and that's certainly one aspect of naturalness, is that code is, as we've seen, predictable and repetitive. But I think there's actually more to this concept. We don't quite know how to formalize it in the right way. And I'll say a little bit about that in the second hour of the talk. So nobody ever laughs when I say that joke. Another type of follow-on work that Prim and his colleagues and Zhendong have done is saying, well, we can do n-grim language models, but maybe like cache language models would be even better. There's kind of local repetition in software. So a cache language model is just an n-gram language model that has kind of an exponentially decaying memory of what n-grams he has produced recently. So that says, well, if I've produced an n-gram like two lines of code ago, I should be more likely to produce that again. And you know, that's actually really convenient in software, because if somebody uses a novel identifier that I've never seen before, like you know, XYZZY or something like that, you know, I won't be able to predict it the first time because I've never seen it. But after that, you know, I'll know that once I've seen it once, I should see it again, even though I never saw it in the training set. So, and there's been a lot, this work, so there's been a lot of work looking at different ways now to model source code text specifically. So for example, with my student Miltos Alamanis, we did n-gram models over larger corpora of projects. So we had cross-project models over, 500 million tokens. And but maybe technically the most interesting experiments that we did in that work were looking at the role of abstractions. So we had different versions of the n-gram language model, you know, one that predicted, you know, every token itself, or one where we kind of collapsed all the identifiers into a special identifier token. And there's interesting things you can learn about the code by the difference between perplexities that you get between those different types of models. So another thing you might think, so a lot of this work about n-gram language models might seem kind of very alien because, you know, I mean, why do we have to resort to an n-gram assumption when I know the grammar of the programming language perfectly? Certainly I should be able to do some kind of grammatical model that would be better than an n-gram model. So it turns out if you just take a vanilla PCFG, it's kind of really hard to kind of extend that to be as good as an n-gram language model. But one thing you can do that does help is if you do kind of a neural based tree structured grammar. So this was work that Chris Madison and Danny Tarlow, who's also here, have done. So this is a language model where you predict the parse tree one node at a time. And to predict the next element of the tree, you can use basically a neural network that can have kind of arbitrary dependence on the parts of the tree that you've generated previously. So that's one way you can do a syntactic language model for code that you can actually make work. And another thing you can do rather than another way you could get grammatical information into the language model is actually just by starting with an n-gram model but annotating the tokens that you're going to present. So Tian Nguyen and co-authors have done some work on saying, okay, what can I add to these tokens in terms of the syntactic context or the semantic context and also interpolating with topic models to take more statistical and semantic information into account. So if I kind of stop here and pause to think about what's different about all of these different types of papers, it's really the level of abstraction, right? Am I interested in predicting individual tokens? Am I interested in predicting clusters of tokens like identifiers? Am I interested in predicting parse trees? So there's different levels of granularity that I can think about this modeling problem, and I'll get different methods by doing that. And I think it's still an open question, you know, for a particular application, which of these language models would be better. So an alternative to looking at syntax would be, you can also look at these things across languages. So you can get some kind of interesting insights into different programming languages by how easy it is to predict tokens in different languages. So this is from a master's project that I supervised over the summer. And so what these are, kernel density estimates, or you could think of them like histograms. So this is over different projects. How easy is it to predict tokens in different programming languages? So on average, there's not. It really depends on the model, kind of which language is easy to predict over C, Java, Python, and JavaScript. You might think that Python and JavaScript would be harder to predict because they don't have types explicitly annotated. But it's not a huge difference. But looking at the variation across projects is really interesting. And this is something that we haven't completely figured out yet. But there do seem to be like different, especially in C and JavaScript, there are different types of projects that seem to be harder to predict. So these are kind of token level or syntactic models, but you could also look at more semantic or data flow properties in order to build the model. So there's been this, yes.
just had the thought, it may very well be that, you know, libraries, right, because they're sort of trying to solve orthogonal problems, you know,
yeah.
A library that does one thing is very different from a library that does something else.
Yeah.
Whereas applications are not that different. So it may be that the sort of higher peaks of entropy might come from libraries, which are relatively different from each other.
Yeah, it could be. That would be, yeah, that'd be really interesting to look at, I think. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the difference in perplexity between the token-based models and the grammar-based model?
Oh, the token-based model and the grammar. Oh, for this. So on this data set, we haven't run the grammar-based model. I don't think that we have a really good evaluation culture yet for these types of models. I don't know. So it's I don't know if there's a comparison that I would trust in terms of the difference in perplexity across these other types of models. So this might be something where we want to do a kind of, you know, better evaluation or benchmark or bake off. Yeah. Did somebody else raise? Yeah.
I'll show some results later, the grammar to n-gram models, but it's on a much smaller data set, so that the sort of the conclusions might be hard to agree.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. He's going to talk about it later. Oh, gosh, why is this? I need to see. I should have. Yeah, anyway, doesn't matter. So another type of model that you can do is more semantic. So this is Martin Vechev and one of his students and Andreas Krause. We're looking at a model to predict. We'll say in this version of the model to predict variable names to make it concrete. You can use it for other properties in JavaScript. And so what they were looking at is rather than treating context as being the last few tokens, they would look at which variable names are used together in the same expression. So they built a conditional random field. Don't worry if you don't know what that is. Or if you don't know what that is, they built a graph. And each node in the graph was one of the variables that they wanted to rename. And you'd put an edge between them if they were used in the same expression. Wherever you have an edge, you also have a table like this, a table of numbers. You could think of this table as being a soft constraint. So what this table corresponds to, let me see, this table corresponds to these two, so the R and the I. And so this is saying if I only look at these two, how compatible do I think all possible names in the universe, ranging from I and J to kind of crazy things like that we really know are function names, how compatible are these would these pairs be if I assigned them to these two variables? So then I build this entire graph, and then to get a probability over all of the names that could be assigned, so if you give me a vector of names for every variable, and the model wants to give you a probability back, what he does is he goes to all the tables, looks up the compatibility values, and multiplies them all together. So these are all greater than zero. So that's kind of a particular probabilistic model, which is called a conditional random field. And there's a particular type of training algorithm that they use, which was actually, it's a bit of a mouthful to say, but it's actually kind of fairly straightforward and intuitive. But if these things don't make sense to you, maybe the important thing is to think of this as a structured prediction problem. So I'm not trying to, it's a structured prediction problem is one where I'm trying to classify many different things at the same time that interact. So here, the name of each variable, I could imagine trying to train an independent classifier for each variable that says what's the best name for I, given his context. But it's more interesting to try to learn how different names interact because they are in the same expression. And it's this kind of structured prediction conditional random field that lets you learn about this kind of interaction. That's kind of more kind of data flow oriented. Another type of work that we've done is looking more at syntactic patterns. So again, some work that Miltos and I have done have been looking for something that we call idioms. So by an idiom, we mean kind of a small-scale syntactic pattern that kind of serves some recognizable purpose. So these are ones that we actually find. So it might be something like, oh, when I use this particular type of cursor object within an Android library, he tends to be within a try-finally block and to call this particular cleanup method. So that's something you could represent as a subgraph of an AST, of an abstract syntax tree, or of a parse tree. So what we do is we have a statistical method that that tries to find kind of subtrees, subgraphs that appear over and over again in a corpus of code, and so that's what this non-parametric Bayesian tree substitution grammar does. So, you know, we built a system that does it. I won't tell you anything about it except the acronym. So we call it HAGIS, which stands for Holistic Automatic Gathering of Grammatical Idioms from Software. I do offer consultancies if you have a project that needs to be named. So that's one type of looking at syntactic patterns from code. Another type of thing you can look at, which I think is really interesting with respect to kind of program repair and bug finding, is looking at changes to software. So there was some work that actually Tom Zimmerman, who is here, was involved in. I think has been very well known, called Dynamine. So this is just about doing association rule learning on commits to software. So if I look at each commit to a software, and I just look at the methods that are added to the code in that commit, and then I treat that as a transaction, the set of methods that are added, and then I do association rule learning. So that way I can say this is something like an invariant, that, you know, when I have a program path in the program that calls this method, he probably also calls this other method. And another thing you can do, another thing that was really interesting from Tian Win's group, is actually looking at how repetitive commits are. So you can say something like, if I have a commit to a software, I can represent that as a pair of abstract syntax trees. I can look at all of the kind of subtrees of each of these, and I can say for each subtree, how often does he repeat in a commit to some other, either some other part in the code or some other project. And it turns out that a substantial number of commits to software projects repeat in this way. So there's kind of some, at least, hope in future work for using this for software repair. So there's a lot of different, if I think about all of these modeling approaches, there's a lot of different design axes that you could think about. Like whether you're trying to do mining from a single snapshot of the repository, or whether, like this, you're trying to do mining from the change history. You know, whether you care about predicting the whole program, like from an n-gram language model that tries to predict every token, that might be good for some applications. But for other applications, maybe I'm only interested in predicting parts of the program. Like maybe I'm only interested in predicting identifier names, like in this Martin Vecev work. And there's also a question of kind of what level of granularity you want to predict in the code. Do I want to predict at the lexical level? Do I want to use syntactic information? Or do I want to use more semantic properties of the code? And, you know, where you want to be in all three of these axes is really going to depend on the application. So with that, I'm going to spend a little bit of time kind of talking about, you know, what are some of the applications that people are already starting to make progress on. One type of application that's kind of really useful is kind of auto-completion. So if I type in a few characters, what is the rest of the identifier that I'm going to use? This is probably one of the most used features of any, it's probably one of the killer apps of any integrated development environment. So there's been work showing, it's actually kind of related when you think about it to n-gram language models, kind of using kind of k-nearest neighbor on the context of a token to kind of rank the list of symbols that you might use to autocomplete a particular prefix. And that that works much better than the kind of default in Eclipse. And you know, there's also been some work on using kind of n-gram language models to do completion. Another type of application that we've seen from the introductions, we've seen there's a lot of people in this room that work on, is code search. So there are deployed code search engines online. When you think about why am I doing code search, so I could be searching either within a project, or which is what an IDE supports. So that might be if I'm looking for a particular feature or a particular method. But it's more interesting to think about why might I do searching across projects. And the reason you do that is because you're searching for examples, right? You want to program by search engine. I have a particular method that I know I want to call, but I'm not sure exactly how to use it. And so this is where code search, a use case where this makes a lot of sense. So there's also kind of a data mining version of code search, which you might think of as a more proactive version of code search, and that's this kind of active research area which is called API mining. So what API mining is about is taking, you know, as I go off to a large number of projects, I find a lot of different places where one particular library is used. So this example is Twitter4j, which is a Java library for accessing Twitter. And there, what I want to do is I want to look at the methods that are being called from the API, and I want to kind of distill them into a set of patterns that says, okay, these are the types of methods that typically get called in sequence when I'm using this kind of library. So it's kind of proactive versus reactive in the sense that if I've just started using Twitter4j and I don't know what methods I want to call in the first place, then I could just use this set of patterns as a starting point. And basically, these types of methods, some of them are more technically, they vary in terms of what techniques that they use, but typically this is viewed as some kind of data mining problem. So I'm looking for, if I view the set of methods that say this function calls as a transaction, then I look for and I view the methods that are called as being items. And I look for sets of items that occur frequently. So it's very much a kind of data mining type of, finding frequent sequences or frequent subsets of each of these methods. Oh, and so another type of application that we've worked on in my group has been about learning coding conventions. So this is more about the communicative aspects of code. Here's an example from one of the most popular Java projects on GitHub, where they have this input stream and they assign it to a variable called I, which is completely ridiculous and horrible, right? You should never call a stream I. This is pointless, right? So what you'd like to do is to be able to say, okay, I want to look at this variable I. I think it's maybe a bit of a not a good name. And I want to suggest other names that could be used instead of I. So you might want to say, okay, if I look at the surrounding tokens from each usage of I, I could say other places in this project have used other names in these contexts. And I'd like to give a ranked list of these. So if you were an n-gram language model, you would really, really like this problem. Right? Because all you have to do is replace I with some other token and report your probability. Right? And that will just kind of automatically give you the, take into account the fact, the number of times that I've seen I in these different contexts. So that was some work we had a lot of fun with, and I think you can demo it or download a plugin at that address. Very closely related to this, I mentioned this model from this Martin Vetchev's group. So they incorporated this into a tool called JS Nice, and this was for deminifying JavaScript. So since with JavaScript, if it's something that's part of a web page, they actually have to send the code, the source, over the wire. So they want to reduce the size of it. So that's minification. So it changes the formatting, and it also makes the names very compact and unreadable. So they applied this kind of model over names that I'm talking about to be able to make this transformation, to do a large amount of renaming all at once. So you're kind of globally searching for a mapping between the minified names and the new names in such a way to make this kind of conditional random field model happy. And so this is something you can go there and there's a demo. They have a demo online that got onto Hacker News and like thousands and thousands of people have tried out. So that's also a good thing. Okay, so I'll skip through some of these, but I want to at least talk about this one because it involves a game. And it's a game that I really like. It's one of my favorite games. I've played it thousands of times in my career. The game is called Name That Java Method. So this is a real method from a project called libgdx on GitHub. No cheating and looking it up while you're here. And so this is a Java game development library. And what this method does is he's got some like string literals that we've kind of collapsed into an uninformative literal. And he creates this thing called a shader program, which I assume is something to do with computer graphics. And then he checks whether it was compiled true. And if the compilation wasn't successful, he throws some exception. So if this were your code, and you wanted to name this function, what would you call it? Just kind of shout out. Get shader. Okay, that's pretty good. Anything else?
Compile shader.
Yeah, good.
Create shader.
That's that's the closest so far. You're still all wrong, but that was the closest one. So this one's called create default shader. That was the actual name. So you might not be able to get from this that it was a default shader, but you should at least be able to get from the body of the method. You should be able to get something like create shader. So, um, So what we did, so we had a paper actually from this FSE about using a kind of a neural network language model over the kind of subtokens, if you split them up on camel case, on the names, that has features from the body and the declaration of the method. This is a really difficult problem. It's far from solved. But it's kind of an interesting challenge problem for these types of methods. So I'm a bit over time, so I'll try to go through some of these more quickly. So a couple of people you've seen from the introductions talked about generation. So either kind of modeling natural language in comments. So that's some really interesting work that Dana and William Cohen have done. And and another area where you can model natural language and text together is if you're doing search. So if you want to do natural language search for source code, you know, so rather than searching PL for PL. And so you can adapt these kind of log bilinear neural network models that I mentioned for that application. And then another type of application that's of interest here is programming synthesis. So this is a really nice quote about program synthesis, which which is kind of one of the fathers of computer science, saying, whenever somebody asks you for a programming language where you only have to say what you want done, give them a lollipop. And program synthesis is about taking that lollipop and running with it. So the idea is that I just specify the desired program output, either by a formal specification or input-output pairs, and you search through the space of possible programs that meet that specification and give me one of them. So this is kind of a very large area in programming language, if you want to know more about it, you can ask Mark. And there's kind of some clear similarities to semantic parsing that kind of would be interesting to explore. Especially when you do program synthesis from natural language, which kind of interestingly enough, there have been two papers from different people at Microsoft Research in the last year, kind of doing kind of different versions, different data sets of this problem from Excel or from recipes of if then if this then from this kind of particular kind of if then rules that you can program. There's a particular website you can program that on. So I think natural language program synthesis, we'll hear, I think, a lot more about this in the coming sessions. And the final thing, I think this is the final thing I wanted to mention, is machine translation, right? So machine translation from code is kind of an interesting thing to do because programmers need to port code between different frameworks and different programming languages. And that you can view that as an MT problem. So Tian has done some work applying phrase-based MT to this domain, and you can actually, it's much easier to translate between Java and C# than it is to translate between programming languages. And other work from Martin Vedchev's group, you can actually essentially intersect phrase-based MT with a prefix grammar of the programming language so that you only generate syntactically correct translations, which a phrase-based grammar on its own wouldn't do. So there's a lot of interesting open problems there. And I can, maybe that's my phone telling me that I should stop talking. So I wanted to just close by kind of reflecting on what's going on in this area. So one thing that I think is really interesting about this area is that it's kind of a new type of program analysis. So we can think of static analysis, we can think of dynamic analysis, but this is really statistical analysis. So it's something very different. But it's kind of, in some ways, it's analogous to static analysis. Because in static analysis, what you do is you take the possible execution traces of the program, and you abstract them in a way that kind of loses information, but gives you tractability. And then once you have this abstract representation of the program state, you do logical inference. Whereas statistical analysis is kind of following an analogous type of analysis, that you construct an abstraction of the program. This abstraction is going to lose information. The reason you conduct this abstraction is for two reasons. One is that one is data sparsity. You want to be able to generalize to programs that you haven't seen, and so the abstraction helps you to generalize. And another thing that happens when you abstract is when you design an abstraction, you are telling the statistical method, these are the parts of the domain that you should pay the most attention to. And that's why we use different statistical models for different problems, because we want the model to remember different things about the training set. So this is what we call adding an inductive bias. And I think we should all know from Fox News that bias is good. And it's definitely good in machine learning. And then once we've done the abstraction, then we do statistical inference. So just as there was a revolution that happened in natural language processing that you might call maybe pejoratively a semantic retreat, so that we stopped doing kind of purely logical approaches or rule-based approaches to natural language processing, and we kind of moved into statistical methods. Because language is very complicated, and you know, it's kind of the only way to kind of cut through that mess is to learn about things from examples. And you know, maybe something similar is going to happen in programming languages. Rather than only doing static or dynamic PL-based analysis, we'll move to statistical analysis of programming languages. So maybe all this stuff I said about modeling human communication was a bit kind of pretentious and highfalutin, and really all we need to do is count die rolls. Because in natural language processing, we are very, very good at counting. And the other thing, I think, another thing is, up until now, in terms of this intersection, what we've been doing is transferring kind of successful methods from natural language processing back into source code. And that's a really good thing, you know, because we've gotten some kind of interesting systems that way. But I think it's also interesting to ask, okay, what's special about software? You know, what is there that's different about computer program text that might require us to actually adapt some of the NLP methods somewhat? And you know, one thing is that the NLP methods are highly lexicalized. So what do I mean by that? Is they typically have parameters in them, if you peer really hard inside the model, that kind of refer to individual words. Like in a phrase-based machine translation, you'll have some weight somewhere in the model that says, how often does this foreign language word translate into this English word? So, and that's why you need so much data, because you have to learn all of these word-by-word statistics. And you know, I wonder, in software, I kind of wonder if we can use the type of abstractions that we see in software, like, for example, types, to kind of have models that are kind of not as strongly lexicalized, but that are still successful in applications. Another thing that's different about software is we have semantics. Right, so the formal semantics of a programming language that's really difficult to reason over, but you can still prove things approximately about the semantics, and that might give you some interesting research directions, and also that you have text from many different modalities. So there's different types of text that are where you have different language models. You want to talk about different things, and you want to integrate information from them. And the final question I wanted to talk about is, you know, you might step back and say, well, look, why are there patterns in software anyway, right? Because if there really was a recurring pattern in a piece of code, then I should refactor it out, and it wouldn't be there anymore. So why is there anything? So maybe the reason that software is kind of predictable and repetitive is because all software is poorly written. And I think there's two answers to that. One is that... one is orthogonality, that if I give you a lot of small pieces that you combine together, which is a good design principle for an API, that they tend to be combined in predictable ways. And so patterns arise that way. And the other reason that patterns arise is because programmers want to make their code conventional. And why do they do that? Because they want their programs to be easily read. So these two programs do the same thing. But one of them you could just glance at and you know what it does, and the other one you'd have to read to figure out what it does. And that's because one's conventional and the other one isn't. So, and in fact, there's a bug in the right-hand version that you can't see easily because it's not written conventionally. So maybe what it means for software to be natural, or part of what it means for software to be natural, is that there's good correspondence between the surface level, looking at tokens, and the semantic level of what it's actually doing. So I think there are, actually, rather than going, since we're short on time, I won't go through this list all at a time, but I think over the course of the workshop, we can talk a lot more about more specific challenge questions within NLP and software engineering. So thank you very much. Yeah.
I love that. So the idea that readability is somehow related to this predictability of the relationship between the surface and the semantics.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, somehow, like, if I could take a large corpus of source code, analyze it using, you know, PL methods, right, have the semantics, in the cases where the conditional probability of the semantics on the code is very high.
Yeah.
The code is very readable.
Yes. Yeah, I think that's interesting.
I like that.
Yeah. I don't know anybody who's done that, but I think
that's really nice. I like that.
Yeah.
I can ask you why you use the concept of idiom, because in natural language, idioms are expressions where the meaning is not necessarily deducible from like kick the bucket, right?
Yes, yes.
So it's not an idiom that you're talking about. It's probably those, you know, recurring expressions which also are present in natural language, where people, especially in some languages, where people use particular expressions, like for instance in real estate, they would say the house boasts whatever.
Yeah.
You understand what it is. It's not an idiom.
Yes.
But it's a language, and it might be that in code you can use this concept of some language, which is very actually, because it's very semanticized, syntax is very semantic.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe this concept of some language could be also applied to code.
Yeah, so I agree that the term idiom is a bit of a abuse of terms, because you know, by definition, programs must be semantically compositional. There's no, it's not possible to have a non-compositional semantics for code. I guess the part where we thought the name had some justification was the idea, we were thinking of them psychologically as chunks, that when I see a code idiom, I don't have to kind of interpret it again in my head to know what it's doing. So, and that was the sense in which we thought it was an idiom, but I agree it's a bit of an abuse. I actually don't know this concept of sublanguage. That might be an interesting one to think about. Yeah.
In the practitioner space, idiomatic code is code that people expect to see. So there are books on how to write idiomatic Perl, idiomatic Python, and it's about how to write code that is readable to others. So they don't use idiom in the same way at all.
Yeah.
But it's comes from practice.
Yeah, actually, that's true. And you can go into Stack Overflow and just type idiomatic into the search box, and you'll get tens and tens of thousands of questions about how do I write this idiomatically.
So it connects to the naturalness.
Yeah, yeah, I think it does. It's a different way of quantifying part of naturalness.
For instance, you take a logical formula and you generate natural language from it without any embellishments.
Mm-hmm.
You get a very awkward, maybe very grammatical, but very awkward English.
Yes.
Then you have to paraphrase to have an idiomatic English, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah, hi, Luke.
So nobody interrupted you, but I was wondering, like, what did you just teach me that was wrong?
Oh, good, good, good. So it could be that what I was hoping is that the intentional mischaracterization was of my own talk. That was optimistically what I was hoping. Okay, great. Well, thank you.
So this is the first session, and we're going to structure this like every other session. So a talk followed by discussions around a bunch of questions that we'll start off with, but we welcome other comments, questions as well. And the scribe should be taking notes. I don't know who's scribing this session. Okay, great. Yeah, Jennifer will be describing the session. And so let's get started with the questions that we have. So what kind of collaborations do we need to move this area forward? Is there any interesting questions that weren't explored by Charles? Any data resources, any benchmarks? So floor's open. Yes.
All right, so one question that wasn't explored was error location, or I don't know if I saw a lot of bug fixing. So program repair.
Go ahead if you have any comments on that topic.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll promote my students' work, of course. Joshua used ngram models, and he found that you could find code that induced syntax errors by basically asking an ngram model, how surprising is this code? And the most surprising windows of code tended to be where your errors were. And it sort of generalized a little bit further beyond just syntax errors. It was also code that was error-inducing and to a certain extent. But the syntax errors thing was a lot more accurate. And then there's always the discussion of program repair, whereas having natural language models allows you to basically decide if a repair looks natural. which is sort of a nice process. So it means in your search algorithm to find repairs, you could kick out those ones which feel unnatural.
So is that something people are doing now, or is it with
the search or the?
They're using the language model like you would in speech or MT for program repair.
I haven't seen it, but we all discuss it like it's obvious.
Yeah, seems natural.
Seems natural.
The question for program repair is like for machine translation, whether you use the language model just as a post-processing to the synthesizer, or whether you really closely embed the language model during the synthesis to really drive the search to a likely effect.
Yeah, so we were talking with the games group at U of A who does a lot of multi-heuristic search, and they were saying that if you do have a model of what is acceptable code, you should really be applying that before you do the expensive step of evaluating that mutation. So you should kick out your mutations early with a language model,
perhaps.
But language model evaluation is pretty fast, so it's better than running the test, which is slow.
Yes, it's a matter of optimization, where you put the prompts.
Yeah. So they're before evaluation. That's when they suggest.
If it's parameter, not only with mutations, so in some cases. So it's indeed a design decision to make.
Yes.
Before, during, or after the patient.
Are there comments on program repair or program fault localization? Are you applying statistical methods for this sort of thing? Any other topics that Charles should have addressed but didn't?
I just get those slides there.
So some work in my group that we have been doing on programming with the essence, that is, right? So suppose we're writing program in Java. And much of the code is actually noise. You don't need to have all the identifiers and all the control structure. You can just give some very important keywords, and you'll be able to kind of reconstruct what the program is. It's like a natural language sentence, right? You have an English sentence, you get rid of some of the words, you'll be able to reconstruct the sentence. So we're kind of doing some work along that direction. Try to build a system that's programming with essence. Right. And although it's a very baby step we're taking at the moment, it all is also involved in that. So I think that would be something interesting. There's some work from MIT by, I think it's Robert Miller's group, called Sloppy Programming. Mm-hmm. Right. That's a very interesting piece of work. It inspired the work that we have done.
Yes.
So I think like for many of those problems, we intend to use AI technologies or NLPs to approximate how human would write something like the naturalness. But for many of the AI problems, actually they are tackling something that human couldn't tackle, right? Here I'm just using an analogy like in software engineering problems. Let's use a concrete example in testing. We are not just synthesizing the tests to look like what human would be writing, but more than human could be writing because the machine could be more powerful in reasoning, provide more than the human could do, right? So I'm wondering whether we could have some thought along that directions, like beyond just what human can do now and further extend the capability with some of those natural language synthesis or processing.
Mm-hmm. Right. So going beyond the ability of humans, but aren't there some vision systems that are performing better than humans?
Well, there's been several cases where in natural language systems, apparently the system has outperformed the humans, but mostly in my experience, that's been an example of where we're using a poor evaluation metric.
I see.
CAPTCHA
stuff.
Well, it depends on which your CAPTCHA is, but these image distorting ones, yeah.
Actually, there's a really nice example in deception detection where computers can often do better than people.
Mm-hmm. Who deceiving who?
So for example, if an online review was actually written by someone that used the product, for example, or if someone's lying when they're saying something, there's some interesting cases where sort of overall surface statistics are just different. You're doing it subconsciously when you're doing it, and so just by looking at the syntactic structures, you can actually tell. It's sort of shocking, mm-hmm. and people aren't sensitive to those cues. But I agree, it's very rare.
Yeah,
but there are some cases.
just to give some warning signs, like I've seen cases where people claim that their machine translation systems give quality that outperforms that of humans, and oftentimes that's because they're using evaluation metrics that just say how close is the machine translation output to some gold standard reference translation of that sentence. But we oftentimes have a single or only four possible reference translations, and the nearness to those is not parameterized particularly well. So yeah, there's some cases where we could get superhuman performance, and but there are also cases where we need to watch the evaluation metrics very carefully. So. Mm-hmm.
One is a question or problem that I don't think was talked about. And that's where we have a specification that's written in natural language and we want to check whether the program actually does what's written there. It's kind of a really difficult problem, but I think that would be a cool problem to solve. And the data resources that are needed, I would like a really clean, like I said before, I'd like a really clean set of parallel language in code where the code does exactly what the language says.
Well, there's Rosetta code, which is not big. But so basically, it's a task described in English and implemented in multiple languages.
Yeah.
But it's not very big. So
it's not
a few hundred, I think,
at most.
Yeah. So, you know,
so something very large, like Stack, mm-hmm. Mine from Stack Overflow or something like that. Mm-hmm.
There's a couple of ported examples of JPET store. They have JPET store in Ruby, and they have JPET store in other things. And it all does the boring JPET store thing. And they got JPET store in Java, of course, because it was a J. But that's basically web app size. And they use that one for, like, Dell uses it for benchmarking. So it's at least good enough that you can hammer it.
Is it natural language?
No, it's not natural language, but it's between, you can get implementations of JPET store in multiple frameworks in multiple languages.
For, like, porting?
Yes,
okay.
But no natural description.
So there might be another option to use some of the competition sites such as HackerRank, which now have you do some fairly complicated efforts where there's the natural language description and they'll get hundreds of examples in many different languages. Unfortunately, because that's a private enterprise, you would need to find a way to partner with them so their data isn't quite as open as some of these other things. Like, that's another spot where somebody knows somebody.
So is Mechanical Turk a way to put up small fragments of code and get English descriptions? Would that work?
Turkers, you can program.
Yeah.
We could qualify them, I guess. So lots of hands going up. I guess that one, yes.
Sure. So to directly answer that question, we tried that over the summer, and some of the folks that were hired to look at that problem through Mechanical Turk did a very good job, and others did a less good job. And in general, we found that the results were unusable at the end, so we had to hire our own experts within the company that we worked with. So if anyone has ideas to make an infrastructure that's similar to that for labeling, actually, this is one of the points on that two-page paper that we're supposed to submit, one of the questions which I asked was this question of how can we get labeling done within the software engineering domain where we can get experts to actually label enough data that we can use these statistical approaches.
So I think a couple other people have that. Don and...
So there's another competitor to Mechanical Turk, and I can't recall its name, but in that you can certify workers ahead of time. So it would enable you to actually test for software understanding before getting them. So, I mean, my general thought was that Mechanical Turkers would be a bad source of people to do this because you can't control for training.
You can qualify Turkers before you hire them.
I think that there's, this other site allows for a lot more oversight so that you can watch them do the task and so that you can have a lot more confidence in it. And so I think that because there's so much knowledge that you need to do a software engineering task, that you'd want something with a little bit more oversight then.
Nate and then Donna.
So I had two thoughts. One is that there's a sort of inherent problem with trying to start with the code and then attach natural language to it, which is that the natural language actually turns out to not be natural. People just literally describe line by line, or they give sort of a very little description of. So I think you kind of have to go the other way. At least this is what I found in my experience. You have to start with the natural language and then generate code. And then people, because the code has to be correct or in some sense, so there's not, you have less of a problem of this going on. And then the second thing is that we found that hiring people on ODesk, where we could basically look at their qualifications, worked much better than Turkers. So then you're just working with one or a few different people, and you build a relationship with those people, and then you get them to do large amounts of annotation for you.
So you have annotated?
Not huge data sets, though. Smallish, you know, hundreds, not thousands, not tens of thousands.
Dana, and then?
Yeah, so I've actually done a similar thing on Mechanical Turk, where I qualified Turkers. What I did in my task is I used Turkers to label relations, software relations, so things like saying, you know, whether a certain thing is a browser or a source code system or whatever. So certain relations within software, and I built a qualification that's exactly the kind of things that I would like them to label, and I identified a small set of users, like Nate said, that are able to do these tasks, and then I sort of had this relationship with them where I pulled up, you know, labeling tasks and had the same set of users do those tasks. And it actually worked very well, and so it can be done, and there's a lot that you can do on the Mechanical Turk platform.
Did you have a look?
So I guess I would also just maybe add to think about, when you think about this problem of code and language, is that in some sense it's not exactly well defined just to say I want the English that goes with this code, right? That's a little unclear. And you know, one way to think about aspect in which it's unclear is just to think about the level of detail at which you're describing the code. So you know, imagine I give you a word budget, I give you 5 words. Your description of the code would be very different than if I said you have to use, you know, at least 50 words. Right, you might say this is a sorting algorithm or something, which would be useful. Or you know, if you had a few more words, you'd say the kind of sorting algorithm. And if you had to use a lot of words, you would go through it line by line or something. Although I would argue that's pretty unnatural in practice. So you know, it's a really important thing, and we should think about data, but we should also think about task definition. Like, what exactly are you trying to do with the language and the code, and not just say there's kind of one, you know, canonical mapping.
I mean, in regards to what you just said, you can also think about the level of specification in the code. So you can describe in a sentence, you know, a class or a method or just a line of code or one statement, right? And so you'll get very different things. So I worked on common prediction for given code fragments. And you get very different things if you are looking at different code fragments, right? So this is sort of the other aspect of what you were saying.
There is this sort of fear, for me at least, about scale of Mechanical Turk. Like, I've had this experience where I put out a small task, and with appropriate quality assurance in place, you know, you have multiple Turkers doing the same task, or you establish a trusted relationship, then you can get quite high quality annotations. As soon as you make that task 10 times as large, then all of a sudden you become much more of a target for spammers and scammers and people who try to do the minimum work necessary in order to get paid for it. So like Mechanical Turk seems like a great way to get started and to do sort of feasibility studies to figure out whether we can get humans to answer these kind of tasks. But I wonder if there's a lot of sort of naturally occurring feedback loop kind of situations and figuring out ways that we can instrument those. It could be a code teaching site where we release some description, or these code competition sites. Like, those might be natural places to gather some of the data.
So I think there's the opposite side of what you're saying too, though, which is that at least my experience has been that if your job is too small, then Turkers don't want to learn anything.
Right.
So once you then move to some scale, you now have this motivation for people to actually try to learn how to do your job correctly and qualify themselves and stuff. So there's trade-offs. Like when you are doing big scale, you have advantages too that you can take advantage of.
This is true.
I'm not sure how feasible this is just yet, but in the data science community, there's an interesting thing coming on with IPython notebooks. Just to go in a different direction than Mechanical Turks, this is a way that data scientists will take natural language descriptions and basically interleave them with code that's executed. And the code doesn't necessarily have to be Python. They have kernels for other languages, but it's relatively new. I don't know if it's robust enough for studies yet, but I think...
So you're talking about like literate programming, right? Yeah. Literate programming, where there's the text and the natural
text.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
But there are, that's a good point. IPython is kind of taking off, right? Like there's notebooks all over the place. Yeah, that's right.
The repositories for these notebooks are certainly something to monitor.
Yeah. So there are many of them on GitHub, and now GitHub can interpret the hybrid notebook directly.
Yes.
Are there particular resources we curate? Like, I feel like one of the the efforts that both spurred some research but also a lot of engineering effort in machine translation was open competitions between systems. Like there was a standard release of data and a sort of benchmark evaluation where both academic and industry people would try to train the best machine translation system they could on a finite set of data resources. And I think that was great in that it spurred people to build really good systems. And I think it was awful in that sometimes the best systems were driven as much by data cleaning and engineering effort and like low-level engineering efforts as they were broad research ideas. So like one thing we could do is to try to encourage people to release large language modeling data sets, and we could bang on perplexity as hard as we could so we could know that this is the best model for predicting the naturalness of a bit of Java code. But I mean, what do you guys think about this? Does it feel like a worthwhile effort?
I mean, we can look at another system, for example, like ImageNet, I mean, other data sets, right? So driving not just academia, also industry, to really, like, I mean, push up the capability of their solution technologies. I think when we design this kind of contest, we need to carefully think about the problem that either very fundamental, like image processing, like ImageNet, or something the automated task would be critical people care about. What's the outcome? I mean, more like end-to-end benefits of that task. Then we could, I mean, gather more participation, more interest, or sustainable interest. I mean, we I mentioned yesterday we had the MSR challenge every year. But I think more or less after that year, I mean, we move on to another thing rather than it's kind of like sustainable or more like a cloud contributed to push it forward. So I think we may think more carefully about what to take us the contest subject.
But so one thing would be nice is, you know, for example, the you know, Don was telling me about a couple of benchmarks in traceability and bug localization. You know, I don't, you know, it'd be nice to kind of get this out to the NL and IR community so they can start banging on it too, so that, you know, I think these seem like really good benchmarks. Did you want to add something, Don, before, to that? Or?
Well, I mean, I don't know how big they are relative to what those communities expect. So, I mean, I think that that's something to think about.
Sorry, Ray, you had your hand up.
Oh, I was just going to say, so Connell, which is the computational natural language learning, has a challenge every year. But one thing they do is they repeat the same challenge at least 2 years. I think some of them have even gone on three, which I think helps add some continuity. And also, once you add the competition, the data set continues to exist, and people still compare to, you know, previous Connell data sets and present new results. So I think sometimes it's not just the contest itself, but it's the fact that the contest gives you the incentive to create the data, and then the data continues to have a life for quite a few years later.
Abram, and then...
Okay, so the code cloners, they came up with a couple of data sets that are now slowly being used for code clone evaluation. And that's sort of been working out, but that's because they have, they went and they defined at least 2 to 3 easy to get at types of clones. So they have a task that's easily defined that you can actually do. In a lot of these cases, it's not so great. I guess like one example that we could have done is maybe the code completion, right? So if you come up with a code completion data set that's very clear with a clear evaluation measure, then at least you'd have something there. But in a lot of this stuff, there isn't necessarily something competitive. Like you can sort of do better, but in a lot of cases, there's many ways to do it. Which I guess is why something like Blue is oftentimes very popular, because there's many ways to do it, but you can at least get close to something.
Yeah, and if you include the comments in that, then you get the natural language aspect automatically.
Jane and then Daniel?
Sorry, I think I jumped in front. So just a comment about the traceability benchmarks. I mean, this is something that our community has really worked on for quite a few years, just because getting traceability data is quite difficult, because you have to have source artifacts, target artifacts, and by source I mean what you're tracing from, not necessarily source code, and then the trace links, and they're not necessarily kind of correct. But what we found the real challenge is kind of benchmarking in terms of how you want to measure the results, because then people throw different solutions at it. Some of it includes, you know, supervised learning or semi-supervised learning, and some of it's fully automatic. So what we had hoped, you know, by having a diverse set of data sets would lead, you know, it's been very, very useful because it's given people data sets to work with. But in terms of the competition aspect, it's actually quite difficult because what the solutions are so varied. And I think the other thing is somebody earlier was talking about kind of application to practice. So in the end, you know, we're working on kind of trying to optimize some metrics on these kind of little data sets, but that's really different from when you look at it in the context of actual tasks that people are going to perform. So these are our challenges that we've had.
Daniel?
So one thing I was going to say about all of these sort of competition-like ideas where you're just releasing source code as a part of it, one thing that we've come across when sort of as machine learning people trying to address problems of modeling source code is there's all of this information that's available through static analysis tools and compilers and different representations of code that you can get at if you learn how to use a compiler and ask it the right questions. And I think this is one barrier to entry in keeping people who aren't experts in software engineering to attack these problems or to sort of use more sophisticated methods than just token level stuff. And so I think an important question is, you can release the source code, but what other representations and analyses on top of this can you release with it such that people can make use of it?
Jay?
So we have a framework called TraceLab. Somebody mentioned it, I think Tao mentioned it at the very beginning. And it's not just for traceability, it's for empirical software engineering experimentation. And we were trying to address this specific problem. Dennis is a PI on this too. And Dennis, actually, maybe you want to mention something about what you did with the software maintenance. And
so basically what we've done, we took 20, 30 papers from a software maintenance community. We identified which techniques people, mostly information field-based approaches, NLP-based approaches, support and so on, are using as parts of those solutions. And we essentially tried to build a component library that would provide researchers a good starting point. If they want to re-implement something, if they just want to take a component, drop it into their experiment and use it as a baseline. So, but we've done it only in the context of mostly software maintenance.
But it's designed to address the problem of people can't kind of reestablish the baselines and then try their new things. And so to kind of try and tackle that access problem and the getting started problem.
So I apologize. I think we're probably going to have to cut this session short just because we need about a five-minute transition period for the next speaker to start. So that's Tian Nguyen. So thank you all for the contributions. And let's try and stay in the room. They should only take about 5 minutes to transition to the next speaker.